Hello all, now today we will be discussing about all non-HIV virus treatment. Okay, for HIV virus please refer to a separate video among HIV virus. So in this section we will be discussing about hepatitis group of virus. Okay, hepatitis virus. Then we will discuss about influenza virus. Thirdly, we will discuss about herpes group of virus. Fourth, we will discuss about a little bit about papilloma virus, drugs for papilloma virus, and finally RSV virus. RSV stands for respiratory syncytial virus. So these are the non-HIV viruses which we will be discussing in this section. So let's start with the first one, that is hepatitis group of virus. Okay, so let's start with hepatitis group of virus. Now, hepatitis virus is of various types like HAV, hepatitis A virus, hepatitis B virus, HPV, HCV, hepatitis C virus, HDV, and HEV. These are the strains of hepatitis group of virus. Now the point is, hepatitis A and hepatitis E virus, they don't require any antiviral drug. There is no need of antiviral drugs in cases of HAV and HEV. The reason is they are self-limiting infection. They are just like a food poisoning. They are self-limiting. Now the point is HDV. HDV causes infection along with HBV. Either it causes co-infection or it causes super-infection along with HBV, hepatitis group B virus. Hence the treatment of hepatitis D virus is same like hepatitis B virus. So the viruses which just require antiviral treatment are two viruses. First is HBV virus, which requires treatment, and second is HCV virus. Okay, so the two virus which requires treatment is hepatitis B virus and hepatitis C virus, and against them we have various antiviral drugs. For them we have various antiviral drugs. So let's start with the first one. Let's see what is the treatment. Okay, hepatitis B virus and hepatitis C virus. Okay, now you will write that in hepatitis B virus there is no treatment required in acute HBV. The only treatment which is required is in cases of chronic HBV infection, but there will be certain exceptions which I will be telling you shortly. So HBV does not require treatment in acute cases because most of the acute cases are self-limiting. Okay, except if there is liver failure. If there is liver failure, sudden liver failure or acute liver failure, then HBV requires antiviral drug. While in HCV, remember, it required treatment in all cases. All cases, whether it is acute or chronic, all cases of HCV require treatment. Okay, while in acute HBV infection, generally the treatment with antiviral is not required. Now let's see what are the drugs we have for HBV and HCV. In HBV, we have oral drug and injectable drug. Again, in HCV, we have an oral drug and an injectable drug. Okay, so that common injectable drug which is given in both HBV and HCV cases is interferons. Okay, that is interferons. Which interferon? You will write interferon alpha 2A and 2B. This is the common injectable drug in cases of both HBV and HCV infection. Now what are the oral drug we have for HBV? The oral drug for HBV, they are known as NAs. They are known as NAs. NA stand for nucleoside or sometimes nucleotide analog. Okay, they are known as nucleosides or nucleotide analogs. Okay, what is their mechanism of action? These drugs, they will inhibit reverse transcriptase enzyme, which we will be discussing shortly. Now, what about the oral drugs in HCV? The first oral drug in HCV we have is ribavirin, which we will be discussing shortly. And second class of drug we have is NS inhibitors. Okay? Second class of oral drug in HCV infection we have is NS inhibitor. NS stands for non-structural protein, which we will be discussing shortly. So let's start with the first one, HBV infection. Okay, hepatitis B virus infection. Okay, so the first question which is expected from you is, which is the common drug for HCV and HBV infection? That is interferon, and it is the only injectable drug we have. So let's start with the treatment of HBV virus. Okay, now the first point is acute HBV. Okay, in acute HBV, remember, there is no treatment required except in cases of acute liver failure. If the liver is suddenly decompensated or failed, then the treatment is required, because most of the cases of acute HBV infection, they are self-limiting. They do not lead to any chronic infection or any symptomatic infection. Okay. Now, the drug of choice for them is tenofovir or entecavir. Okay. Just write the names. I will be telling you what these drugs are. Okay, so most of the cases of acute HBV virus does not require treatment except in cases of acute liver failure. Now, the second point you will write is chronic HBV. Remember, chronic HBV, it requires treatment. It requires treatment. Okay, now when to start treatment in chronic HBV? Now, when to start treatment? When the patient will meet any of this given criteria. If the patient HBV DNA load or DNA copies is more than 2000 international unit per ml, then this will require treatment, and the patient is HBe negative. HBe is an antigen in HBV virus. Or the patient HBV DNA copies is more than 20,000 international unit per ml when the patient is HBe positive, then we must start the treatment. Okay. Second case when we must start the treatment is when the patient is having two times the level of ALT. ALT stands for alanine aminotransferase enzyme, which is a marker of hepatitis injury, cellular injury of hepatitis virus. Okay, when the ALT level is more than 20 times above the upper limit of normal, as compared to normal subject, the level of ALT is more than 2 times. Third, you will write if the patient age is more than 40 years and the patient family history is of positive, and the patient in this family history has suffered from cirrhosis or HCC. HCC stands for hepatocellular carcinoma, that is a cancer history. And if the patient HBs is an antigen which is present on the surface of HBV virus, that is why S is elevated more than 6 months. Elevated for more than 6 months, then we considered the patient as chronic HBV virus patient, and we must start the treatment. Okay, and we must start the treatment. Let's see what is the treatment we have. What are the drugs we have for HBV? The first drug we have is interferons. Okay, first drug we have is interferons, and which interferon? We will write the short form as interferon alpha. Interferon alpha. Which variety? You will write 2A or 2B. These are the subtypes of interferon alpha. Now, these interferon, where they are given in HBV? First, we will write their role in HBV. Hepatitis B virus. Remember, they are given when the patient is having HBe positive. Okay, HBe positive, then it is preferred. Why? Because it causes rapid HBe antigen loss. Okay, second, it is also preferred. You will write it causes HBs antigen loss fastest. The patient will become HBs negative fastest with this drug, and it is also the drug of choice if the patient is having HDV positive, co-infection or super infection. Co-infection or super infection. So if the patient is having HDV virus also along with it, then most preferred drug is interferon. Okay, HBs, HBe and HDV. Remember, what is the advantage of using interferon? The advantage of using interferon is it is having finite treatment. Finite treatment means it is given for 48 to 52 weeks. Okay, 48 to 52 weeks or around 1 year. The treatment given is around 1 year. But what about oral drugs, which we will be discussing afterward? Oral drugs, they are given indefinitely or lifelong. Oral drugs are given lifelong. So interferon is given for just 48 to 52 weeks. Now, what is the importance? You will write this interferon is absolutely contraindicated if the patient is cirrhotic. In cirrhosis of liver, interferon is absolutely contraindicated. The reason is it increases the risk of infections. It increases the risk of infection because interferon, I will be telling you now shortly, they reduces the immunity of our body. Okay, it increases the risk of infection and the patient may deteriorate. Okay, that is why. And it is also contraindicated in acute HBV infection. So interferon should not be given in cirrhosis of liver and acute HBV infection. Okay, so let's see first, what is the mechanism of action of interferon alpha? What is the mechanism of action of interferon? Now, interferons, remember, they have antiviral plus anti-cancer property. Okay, they have antiviral as well as anti-cancer property. Because of this reason, interferon alpha, it has been approved in certain viral infection and certain cancers. The virus where it has been approved is HBV virus, hepatitis B virus, hepatitis C virus, okay, and hepatitis P, sorry, HPV virus, which stands for human papilloma virus. Human papilloma virus. Okay, which causes one disease known as condyloma acuminata, which we will be discussing shortly. Now, this interferon alpha has been approved for certain cancers like lymphomas. Okay, lymphomas like, you will write, hairy cell leukemia. Okay, it has been approved for follicular lymphoma. Has been approved for malignant melanoma. Okay, and you can also write in HIV one tumor is seen, Kaposi sarcoma, which is caused by human herpes virus 6, HHV 6 virus. Okay, so try to, sorry, HHV 8 virus, sorry, okay, HHV-8 virus. So it has been approved. Now what is the mechanism of action? The action is interferon, they have broad spectrum of action. They are broad spectrum drug. Remember, they inhibit cell division, especially on those cells which are having virus in it. Okay, now what is the main mechanism of action? We will write interferon, they interfere with, that is why they got their name interferon, because they interfere with protein synthesis inside the cell. Okay, these protein, let's call them as oncoproteins. Remember, these virus, HBV, HCV, human papilloma virus, they themselves, their genes or their genetic material can act as an oncogene. They can produce cancers. Okay, so they inhibit the, interfere with the proteins known as oncoproteins. How? Because they decrease oncogene expression. Oncogenes are those genes which are present in our DNA. They are generally similar to viruses and they form certain proteins which can lead to cancers. So they decrease oncogene expression. Okay. Secondly, they increase MHC. MHC stands for major histocompatibility complex 1 expression. When MHC 1 expression is increased, remember, it increases the activity of, it increases the activity of various killing cells like natural killer cells. Okay, macrophage, and you will write T cytotoxic cell, TC cells. These cells, they will come and they will do phagocytosis. They will eat up this cell. They will cause phagocytosis and they will eat up the cell. So in first reason, they will inhibit the expression of oncoprotein and they also increase the activity of WBCs like macrophage, T cytotoxic cells, and which leads to phagocytosis. Recently, you will write, they also cause apoptosis of cell. This cell will itself die. This cell will itself die. Why? Because it increases the activity of certain proteins which causes apoptosis. These proteins are known as caspases. Okay, caspases. So their main mechanism of action is they interfere with protein synthesis. Okay, and these proteins are known as oncoproteins. Hence the cell division will be inhibited, especially in these, those cell division which are having virus in it. Now these interferon, how do they produce such kind of effect? Interferon, they will go and attach on the cell surface. On the surface of the cell, they produces this changes because interferon, they act on the receptors on the surface of cell which will produce this effect. The receptors is known as JAK-STAT receptor. Okay, JAK-STAT receptors. Okay, so the receptor of interferon is JAK-STAT receptors. Now let's see what are the side effects. What are the, sorry, side effect before side effect, what are the uses? We have already discussed the uses of interferon alpha. Okay, we have already discussed the uses of interferon alpha, but remember, our body also produces interferon beta and interferon gamma also. Okay, so alpha, we have discussed the uses of interferon alpha already. Okay, now let's see the uses of interferon beta. Interferon beta, remember, it has been approved for multiple sclerosis, one autoimmune disease. It is used in multiple sclerosis, and interferon gamma, it is given in chronic granulomatous disease. It is approved in chronic granulomatous disease. It has also been approved for malignant. It has been approved for malignant osteopetrosis. Okay, so if there is any granulomatous inflammation, interferon gamma. Interferon gamma is mainly mediated, it is mainly released by macrophages. Okay, so it is given in
chronic granulomatous disease, malignant osteopetrosis. Okay, now let's see what are the side effects of interferon. Interferon, remember, their most common side effect is flu-like symptoms, or you can write influenza-like symptoms. Remember, when any viral infection occurs in our body and we suffer from symptoms of viral infection, it is not because of virus, it is because of production of interferon by our body. These interferon produces the symptoms of viral infection, okay, like fever, cough, coryza, headache, malaise, etc. They are produced by interferon. Now let's see what are the other side effect of interferon. Interferon suppress, you'll write, it causes bone marrow suppression. Bone marrow, S for suppression. It causes CNS suppression, which can lead to depression or mood changes. It can also lead to thyroid suppression, which can lead to hypothyroidism. So it leads to bone marrow suppression, CNS depression, and hypothyroidism. And lastly, you will write, it is highly hepatotoxic. It itself is highly hepatotoxic, and it is highly neurotoxic, which may cause seizures. Okay, highly neurotoxic as well. Now, what are the preparations of interferon alpha we have? Now, interferon alpha, it is of two type, that is interferon alpha 2a and interferon alpha 2b. It depends upon the amino acid sequence. Now, this interferon alpha, it has been approved for the treatment of hepatitis group of virus in children more than 5 years. Okay, HBV in children's more than 5 years, while interferon L beta is approved in children more than 1 years. Okay, now how it is given? Route, these interferon, remember, they are given by subcutaneous injection or intramuscular injection. Most commonly they are given by subcutaneous injection. Now you will write that interferon alpha, it is given once a week, subcutaneous injection, while interferon beta alpha 2b, it is given 3 times a week. And what precaution you should take? You will write, the precaution we should take is both of them reduce the dose in renal failure. Okay, the last point is, these interferon, they are now given as pegylated forms, which is also known as PEG interferon 2A or 2B. PEG stands for polyethylene glycol. Okay, PEG stands for polyethylene glycol. It is also known as pegylated. Now, when we pegylate them, remember, it makes the interferon long-acting. So, remember, in any drug, if we attach a word PEG or polyethylene glycol, the drug becomes long-acting. Why the drug becomes long-acting? Because when we will give the injection, it will have slower absorption and it will have reduced clearance from kidney. That means it will remain in the blood for longer duration of time. Okay, so pegylated forms are longer acting forms. Now let's
talk about other drugs. Let's talk about now oral nucleoside or nucleotide analog. Which are given for HBV, okay, HBV infection, hepatitis B virus infection. Now, what are the drugs we have? First, we will write the names of the drugs which are approved. You'll write first line drug and second line drug. Among first line, we have two drug, tenofovir and entecavir. Okay, so these are the drug for HBV, chronic HBV. Among second line, you will write LAT-LAT. One is lamivudine. A for adefovir. And lastly, telbivudine. Okay. Now, why they are considered as a second line drugs, why they are not used initially? Because the resistance to them is very common. That is why tenofovir and entecavir, they are first line drug, because the resistance chance is very less. Now, what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? All these drugs, they are fake nucleoside or fake nucleotide analog. Okay. Now, what happens when HBV virus, remember, is a DNA virus. Okay? It's a double-stranded DNA virus. When DNA enters into the cell, this DNA, remember, it forms RNA, which is known as transcription. After this RNA again forms DNA. And this DNA forms hepatitis B virus. And this virus is exited out of the cell. Okay. Now remember, to form RNA to DNA, what enzyme is required? The enzyme which is required is reverse transcriptase enzyme. Okay. Reverse transcriptase enzyme. Okay. Which is also known as RNA dependent DNA polymerase. Now these drugs, they inhibit this enzyme. They inhibit conversion of RNA into DNA. Okay. So they inhibit reverse transcriptase enzyme, and reverse transcriptase enzyme is also known as RNA dependent DNA polymerase. So the mechanism of action of these drugs is they inhibit reverse transcriptase enzyme. Hence, they inhibit the conversion of RNA into DNA. Okay. Now, what is the route of administration of these drugs? You will write the route of administration is oral. Oral. They are given orally. And remember, they are given lifelong indefinite treatment. Okay? Indefinite treatment. So let's start with the first drug, that is tenofovir. Okay, tenofovir, you will write, it is the most effective drug. Why it is the most effective drug? Because it decreases HBV DNA replication to maximum. It decreases HBV DNA level to the maximum. The second point is, there is no resistance against tenofovir. There is no development of resistance against tenofovir. No. Okay. And it is even effective in lamivudine and other drug resistant cases. It is even effective in resistant cases of other drug. And last point is, tenofovir is, apart from HBV, it is also the drug of choice for HIV, because HIV virus also requires are reverse transcriptase enzyme. Okay, so it's a reverse transcriptase inhibitor. So it is both HBV and HIV drug. It is effective against both HBV and HIV drug. Okay, now remember, for both HBV and HIV, there are three drugs which are effective. These drugs are LET. The drugs which are effective against both hepatitis B virus and HIV virus are lamivudine, emtricitabine, and tenofovir. Now, one point you have to remember that this lamivudine, emtricitabine, and tenofovir, these three drugs are effective against HBV and HIV. Lamivudine has been approved for both HIV and HBV. Tenofovir is also been approved for both HIV and HBV, but entecavir is only approved for HIV. Right now, this entecavir has not been approved for HBV, but it is found to be effective against HBV. Okay, so entecavir, emtricitabine, is effective against HBV, but it is not approved. So the drugs which are approved for both HIV and HBV virus are lamivudine and tenofovir. Okay, lamivudine and tenofovir are approved for both HIV virus and HBV virus. Emtricitabine is effective but not approved for hepatitis B. It is only approved for HIV virus. Okay, so try to remember. Now let's see what is the indication and dose of tenofovir. Tenofovir is given 300 milligram orally once a day OD lifelong for children more than 2 years of age. For children more than 2 years of the age. And what is the side effect of tenofovir? Tenofovir, you will write, its main side effect is nephrotoxicity. In nephrotoxicity, remember, it causes Fanconi syndrome. Okay, it causes Fanconi syndrome, which we have already discussed in HIV virus. What happens in Fanconi syndrome? The PCT of the kidney doesn't function. This PCT. The normal function of PCT is to absorb calcium and phosphate back into the blood. This is the normal function. When PCT of the kidney is not functioning, the calcium and phosphate, they will not get reabsorbed back into the blood. This calcium and phosphate, they are lost into the urine. The calcium and phosphate will be lost in urine. Because of this reason, the calcium and phosphate are lost into the urine, the patient will have reduced bone mineral density, because bone require calcium and phosphate, which can lead to osteoporosis. It can lead to osteoporosis. Why? Because calcium and phosphate from PCT of the kidney is not reabsorbed, and this syndrome is known as Fanconi syndrome. Okay, now let's talk about the second drug, that is entecavir. Now entecavir, remember, it is always combined with other drug. It is never given alone. So it is just like tenofovir and other drug. It is also a reverse transcriptase inhibitor. It is always combined with other drug. And the best combination, it is combined with tenofovir. Tenofovir with entecavir combination is considered as a best combination, and it is better than entecavir alone. Okay, now the point is, why entecavir should not be given alone? Because of the high chance of development of resistance. Resistance might develop. Okay. Okay, now the point is, if the resistance will develop, remember, entecavir may show cross resistance. Entecavir will show cross resistance with lamivudine. So, because of this reason, it is not effective in lamivudine-resistant cases, while tenofovir was effective in lamivudine-resistant cases. We will come back to it. Now, let's talk about the side effect of entecavir. The main side effect of entecavir is lactic acidosis. Okay? And what is the dose and indication? It is given 0.5 milligram, okay, orally, or 1 milligram in cases of cirrhosis of liver. In cirrhosis of liver, we must increase the dose, okay, orally, lifelong. Again, for the children more than 2 years of age. Okay, so tenofovir and entecavir, they are given for children more than 2 years of the age. Now let's talk about second line drug. Now second line drug, we will write, there are three LAT LAT. The first is lamivudine. Okay, now lamivudine has been approved for children more than 2 years of age. Okay, now resistance is very common. Now why resistance? How the resistance to lamivudine has developed? Resistance to lamivudine has been developed due to a mutation in reverse transcriptase enzyme. Mutation in reverse transcriptase enzyme to which lamivudine will not bind. Okay, reverse transcriptase enzyme. Okay, this mutation is known as, you have to remember, YMDD mutation. Okay, this mutation is known as YMDD mutation. Because of this reason, resistance to lamivudine develops commonly. Now remember, in resistant cases of lamivudine, tenofovir is the drug of choice. Tenofovir is the drug of choice because tenofovir is the HBV remains susceptible to tenofovir. So completely susceptible. Okay, but remember, in cases of lamivudine resistant cases, what about entecavir and edifovir? Entecavir and edifovir, they are partially susceptible. They can kill HBV virus partially, not completely. So they are partially effective. Tenofovir is completely effective against lamivudine resistant cases. Entecavir and edifovir are partially effective. Okay, now next drug is edifovir. Edifovir has been approved for the children more than 12 years of age only. Okay, and why it is not the first line drug? The reason is resistance is common. Okay, resistance is common, and just like tenofovir, edifovir is also nephrotoxic. Edifovir is also nephrotoxic just like tenofovir. And the last drug we have is telbivudine. Telbivudine has been approved for children more than 16 years of age. Okay, and this telbivudine is the only drug, safest HBV drug in renal failure. So it is a drug of choice among HBV virus for renal failure patient. Okay, so it has been approved for HBV, and in renal failure it is the drug of choice, telbivudine. Okay, so let's make a summary of HBV virus drug. Summary or important points with HBV virus drugs, anti-HBV virus. So first one, you will write safest in renal failure. Okay, that is telbivudine. Second point, you will write drug that dose must be reduced in renal failure, or the drug that requires monitoring in renal failure. because they will be the most dangerous drug. Okay, they will reduce require monitoring, or you will write reduce the dose. Okay, how do will do you do monitoring in renal failure? Remember, you will measure serum creatinine level. Okay, serum creatinine level. So the most unsafe drug in renal failure are, you will write tenofovir and edifovir. Tenofovir and edifovir are the most unsafe drug in renal failure. Okay, you will write the only approved drug in children in the age group of 1 to 2 years, that is interferon alpha 2b. Okay, interferon alpha 2b, it is the only drug which has been approved for children more than 1 year. Okay, 1 to 2 years, this is the only drug. Lastly, you will write common drug for HIV plus HBV which have been approved, that is tenofovir and lamivudine. Okay, so common drug for HBV and HIV which have been approved is tenofovir and lamivudine, but we know emtricitabine is also effective, but that is not approved. So these are the drugs we have for HBV virus. Let's start with now hepatitis C virus. Hepatitis C virus. Now remember, hepatitis C virus is an RNA virus. Okay, hepatitis B virus was a DNA virus, we have discussed. Okay, DNA virus. Now let's see how hepatitis C virus infects a human. Suppose this is HCV virus, and HCV virus contains single-stranded RNA. Okay, now it enters into the human cell. Suppose this is a human cell. So this single-stranded RNA enters into the human cell. Okay, and it undergoes translation. It undergoes translation and it forms various proteins. It forms various proteins. Okay, so these proteins, we will be discussing which proteins are formed. But before that, remember, these proteins, they will go inside the nucleus. They will go inside the nucleus and they will make attached to the human gene cell, and it will make HCV copies. And these HCV copies will be formed, and HCV virus will be thrown outside. Multiple copies of HCV virus will be formed. Now, what proteins are formed by HCV virus? You will write, the proteins which are formed by HCV virus are divided into two. The proteins which are formed by HCV virus are of two. You will write, the first protein you will write is structural proteins. Okay, and then you will write certain non-structural protein. Okay, now what happens with structural protein? Structural protein, they define the structure of HCV virus. They define the structure of HCV virus. These proteins are, you will write core protein, E1 protein and E2 protein. These are the structural protein. Now non-structural protein, they are known as NS protein. NS means non-structural protein. Okay, so these non-structural proteins are of various types, like NS1, NS2, NS3, NS4. Now NS4 is of two type. You'll write NS4A and NS5A. Sorry, NS4B. Then you will write NS5. What is the function of these proteins? I will be telling you shortly. So NS5A and NS5B. What is the function of these proteins? That we will be discussing shortly. So these are the proteins. NS means non-structural protein. which help in replication of virus, which also gives in latency of virus. Latency means it will remain dormant. Structural protein, they are the structural component. Now let's move forward. Let's see what are the drugs we have for HCV. Okay, the first point you will write is injectable drug. The only injectable drug for HCV virus is interferon alpha. Now the point is, it is the only drug which is effective in both HCV as well as HBV. So the common drug between HCV and HBV is interferon alpha. But remember, nowadays we don't use or rarely use interferon alpha. Nowadays we rarely use HCV. Now in case of HCV, nowadays we use oral drugs. Now among oral drugs, we have two drugs. You will write ribavirin and NS inhibitors. So let's talk about these oral drugs. Ribavirin and NS inhibitors. So these drugs are now commonly used. So let's make a heading, ribavirin. Now ribavirin, what is the mechanism of action? You will write, ribavirin inhibit RNA polymerase enzyme of this RNA virus. RNA polymerase enzyme. Okay, now what are the uses of ribavirin? You will write, ribavirin is given for HCV virus. And how it is given? It is given orally. Okay, now remember, it is not the drug of choice. It is given as an add-on drug to NS inhibitors, that is non-structural protein inhibitors. Hence, can we say that NS inhibitors now are the drug of choice for HCV virus? Okay, NS inhibitors, they are now the drug of choice. Ribavirin is just the add-on drug. Okay, now second point you will write, it is also given in respiratory syncytial virus. Okay, and how it is given? It is given by aerosols. And you will write, it is the drug of choice for treatment of RSV virus. Okay. Third, you will write, it is also the drug of choice in hemorrhagic fevers, because hemorrhagic fever is also caused by RNA virus. So can we say that ribavirin is given in all RNA viruses? All types of RNA viruses, we give ribavirin. Now which hemorrhagic fever? You will write, in hemorrhagic fever, it is given IV because it could be very dangerous. Okay, in life-threatening hemorrhagic fever, it is given IV. So you can write the names of those life-threatening hemorrhagic fever. So these fever are Congo fever, Hantaan fever, Argentinian fever, and Lassa fever. Okay, Lassa fever. Okay, so it is given in hemorrhagic fever. Recently, this RSV virus has been approved for thyroid cancer as well. thyroid cancer as well, because it has anti-cancer property. Ribavirin has anti-cancer property. So let's talk about the side effect of ribavirin. Ribavirin is an approved drug for children only more than 5 years of age. In cases of HCV, it has been approved for only children more than 5 years. The main side effect of, or the most common side effect of ribavirin, is hemolytic anemia. Hemolytic anemia. Remember, in pregnancy, ribavirin is absolutely contraindicated. Okay, it is category X drug. Category X drugs are absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy because it is a proven teratogen. Okay, it's a proven teratogen. Okay, it is highly embryotoxic and mutagenic drug. That is why it is absolutely contraindicated. Now let's talk about these new drugs for HCV, which are known as non-structural protein inhibitors, which is also known as NS inhibitors. Now these drugs, they are also known as DAA. DAA stand for direct acting antivirals. They are also known as direct acting antivirals. Now these drugs, they have become the drug of choice for HCV infection. Okay, they have become the drug of choice for HCV infection. Now these drugs are oral, and these drugs are of three type. We have the first one we have is NS3 and 4A inhibitors. Okay, now this NS3 and 4A enzyme, remember, it is also known as protease enzyme. This NS3A, 3 and 4A, it is also known as protease. That is why these drugs are known as protease inhibitors. Now, what is the function of this protease inhibitor? Remember, it inhibits the formation of replication complex. Now, replication complex is required for division of RNA and DNA. Okay, replication complex. And these drugs, remember, they will end with the word Prevnar. They will end with the word Prevnar. All these drugs, they will end with the word Prevnar. We will write the name shortly. Then we have NS5A inhibitor. Okay, NS5A inhibitor. Now this NS5A, it is a part of, there is no special name, part of replication complex. Okay, it is a part of replication complex through which DNA and RNA are synthesized. Now these drugs, remember, they will end with the word Asvir. They will end with the word Asvir. So A word is coming, Asvir. Now third, you will write NS5B inhibitor. NS5B inhibitor. NS5B is also known as RNA polymerase. It is also known as RNA polymerase. Hence, they are also known as RNA polymerase inhibitor. Okay. And these drugs, you will write, they will end with the word Buvir. They will end with the word Buvir. So NS3A4A inhibitor, they will end with the word Prevnar. 5A inhibitor, they will end with the word Asvir. And 5B inhibitor, they will end with the word Buvir. So let's write their names. Keeping this thing in mind, you can write a mnemonic: sabotage. Sabotage all people. You can write a mnemonic: sabotage all people. S for Cimeprevir. So sabotage all people. Bosiprevir. Telaprevir.
Grazoprevir, you'll write Asunaprevir, and lastly Peritaprevir. Okay, so as you are seeing, NS3 and 4A inhibitor, which is a protease inhibitor drug, they are ending with the word Previr. So the mnemonic is sabotage all people, sabotage SBTG all people. Okay, Asvir. So these drugs are NS5A inhibitor. A word is coming, Asvir. So you can write a mnemonic, loved. Loved. So the drugs are Ledi, Pasvir, Ombitasvir, Velpatasvir, Elbasvir, Declatasvir. So it is very important that you must identify them. You have to identify the word Asvir. Asvir means 5A inhibitor. Okay, and NS5B, only two drugs are there. They will end with the word Buvir, because NS5B, B word is coming. You'll write Sofosbuvir and Dasabuvir. Only two drug. Okay, Sofosbuvir and Dasabuvir. Okay, so let's see what is the treatment of HCV virus. Treatment of HCV virus. Now in HCV, remember, all patients, they require antiviral drug. Okay, and there are six genotypes. There are various genotypes of HCV virus, generally 1 to 6. There are six genotypes of HCV virus, 1 to 6. Okay. Now let's see what are the drugs which are approved. You'll write the first approved treatment is Sofosbuvir. So Buvir word is coming. So it will be NS5B inhibitor with Velpatasvir. Velpatasvir. Asvir word is coming. That means it will be NS5A inhibitor. Okay. This treatment is given for 12 weeks. And this is the best treatment we have, because it is approved for all types of HCV genotypes. Okay. So this is the main treatment of HCV virus, NS5B and NS5A inhibitor. They are approved for the treatment of all HCV virus for 12 weeks. Now let's see what are the other approved regimens you will write. You will write again Sofosbuvir with Ledipasvir. Okay. Again, it has been approved for 12 weeks. But remember, it has been approved for HCV 1, 4, 5, 6 genotype, not for 2 and 3, and it has been approved for HCV plus HIV co-infection. Okay, HCV and HIV co-infection. Third, you will write again Sofosbuvir plus Declatasvir. Again, this treatment has been approved for 12 weeks, and it has been approved for HCV 3 genotype. Okay, also for HCV with HIV co-infection. Okay, now what are the other regimens you will write? Fourth, Peritaprevir with
ombitasvir. Now, Prevair word is coming, so it is a NS3-4A inhibitor, that is a protease inhibitor, asvir, NS5A inhibitor. Now, this treatment has been approved for 12 weeks for the treatment of HCV 4 genotype. Okay, HCV 4 genotype. Now, in this treatment regimen, if you will add dasabuvir, okay, if you will add dasabuvir in this treatment, that means with peritaprevir, ombitasvir and dasabuvir, this has been approved for HCV 1B and HCV 1A genotype. Okay, for 1B it is given for 12 weeks, for 1A it is given for 24 weeks. Okay, and lastly you will write Grazoprevir plus Elbasvir. Now this treatment has been approved for 16 weeks and this treatment is the treatment of choice in patient of renal failure. In patient of renal failure, we give combination of this drug, okay, with any HCV genotype. Okay, now just note special point. You'll write with protease inhibitors in HCV, they end with the word Prevair. We have discussed, while protease inhibitors are also used in HIV virus, and in HIV virus they will inhibit in end with the word Navir, Ritonavir. Example, Ritonavir. Here you can write an example, Cimeprevir. Okay, so protease inhibitor, remember we have discussed protease inhibitor in HCV also and HIV also. In HCV, the protease inhibitor, they end with the word Prevair, while in HIV they end with the word Navir. Okay, now remember this Ritonavir is a CYP 3A4 inhibitor. It is a CYP 3A4 inhibitor. This Ritonavir, it is combined with both protease inhibitor in HIV, that means it is combined with other protease inhibitor with of HIV, and it is also combined with protease inhibitor of HCV. Okay, example, let's say right here as lopinavir, okay, sequinavir, etc. Here it is combined with, you can write perita, prevair, etc. And why it is combined? Because these protease inhibitor, they are degraded by CYP enzyme. So why ritonavir is combined? To boost the plasma concentration, because these protease inhibitor, they are degraded by CYP3A4 enzyme, and ritonavir is among them a protease inhibitor which will inhibit CYP3A4 enzyme. Hence it will inhibit the degradation or boost the concentration of both protease inhibitor which are used in HIV and HCV. Hence ritonavir is combined with both protease inhibitor of HBV and HCV and HIV infection. Okay, and this combination is known as boosted PI. Boosted means increase the level. Boosted PI means boosted protease inhibitor. Okay, now certain new drugs for HCV, remember they are right now not approved, दे आर राइट नाउ अंडर ट्रायल्स. तो यू कैन राइट द नेम्स ऑफ दोज ड्रग. द फर्स्ट ड्रग यू विल राइट इज मीरावीरसेन. मीरावीरसेन, रिमेंबर इट्स एन एंटीसेंस ओलिगोन्यूक्लियोटाइड. We have already discussed antisense oligonucleotide. Suppose this is an RNA. Against this RNA, we have made an opposite. Opposite means antisense nucleotide sequence. Hence, it will inhibit RNA transcription. RNA translation. Hence, it will inhibit the RNA of HCV virus. It will directly go and attach to the RNA of HCV virus and inhibit the translation of HCV virus RNA. We have made a complementary sequence to the RNA of HCV virus. But right now this drug is not approved. Second drug you can write is elisporivir. Elisporivir, remember, is a cyclophilin A inhibitor. Okay. Cyclophilin is a protein of HCV virus. So these are the new drugs for HCV which are rightly not approved. So this is all about hepatitis group of virus. Okay. Hello all. Now let's discuss about certain antivirals against herpes group of virus. Okay. Now herpes virus, remember, is a DNA group of virus. Okay. And it contains various viruses. It contains various viruses like herpes, simplex virus, which is of two type, HSV1, HSV2. Okay. It also have virus, you will write varicella, zoster virus. Okay, varicella zoster virus. Now any infection of herpes group of virus, HSV1, HSV2 and varicella zoster virus, which causes chickenpox or shingles, remember, the drug of choice for both treatment and prevention is acyclovir. So acyclovir is the drug of choice for herpes simplex virus 1, 2 and varicella zoster virus. Okay. And now we have made certain congeners of acyclovir also, modified the forms of acyclovir also. So, but the traditionally the drug of choice is acyclovir. But there is one virus, you will write the third virus, that is CMV virus. CMV stands for cytomegalovirus. Okay. Against cytomegalovirus, remember the drug of choice is not acyclovir, it is ganciclovir. Okay. The drug of choice for cytomegalovirus is ganciclovir. Now you will write, why acyclovir is not given for CMV virus? Because acyclovir is not effective against CMV virus. Okay. Acyclovir is not effective against CMV virus. Now, what about ganciclovir? Remember, ganciclovir is effective against all these virus, but ganciclovir right now is not approved. Okay, and we have various modifications of ganciclovir, which we will write as ganciclovir congeners. Okay, now we will write in cases of acyclovir and ganciclovir resistant cases. In acyclovir and ganciclovir resistant cases, you will write the drug of choice is foscarnet. Okay, the drug of choice is foscarnet. What is that drug? We will discuss shortly.
which is better than a drug, sidofovir. Which is better than a drug, sidofovir. In resistant cases of both acyclovir and ganciclovir, the drug of choice is foscarnet, better than a drug, sidofovir. Okay. Now you will write, in foscarnet resistant cases and sidofovir resistant cases of CMV virus. CMV virus, remember, causes CMV retinitis. The drug of choice is fomivirsane. The drug of choice is fomivirsane. Okay. Plus we have a new drug. The drug of choice is fomivirsane. The new drug is letermovir. The drug is letermovir. So these are the drugs which are, this is a new drug for treatment of CMV virus retinitis. Okay. So foscarnet is given for all cases of acyclovir resistance, where acyclovir is used, and ganciclovir is used. Okay, foscarnet. Even in foscarnet resistant cases, we give fomivirsane, and fomivirsane right now has been approved for CMV virus retinitis. Now you will write that sidofovir has been approved for all other DNA viruses, which we will be discussing shortly. Sidofovir has been approved for many other or all other DNA viruses. So this is the summary of herpes group of virus. So I'll repeat again, for HSV1 or HSV2, which is a herpes simplex virus, and varicella zoster virus, the drug of choice is acyclovir and congeners. Cyclovir is coming, but for CMV virus, cytomegalovirus, acyclovir is not effective. In CMV virus infection, the drug of choice is ganciclovir. Okay. Now, in acyclovir and ganciclovir resistant cases, because resistance to acyclovir and ganciclovir is common, for all these viruses, the drug of choice is foscarnet, which is better than a drug, sidofovir. And in foscarnet resistant cases, especially of CMV retinitis, we give fomivirsane. A new drug is letermovir. Okay, so this is the summary. So let's see first, what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? Okay, let's see first, what is the mechanism of action of acyclovir and ganciclovir? Okay, both these drugs, remember, they are fake guanine analog. Both these drugs are fake guanine analog. Now what will happen? They will enter into a human cell. Both of these drugs, they will enter into a human cell. First, they will be converted into guanine monophosphate. One phosphate will be attached. And after that, two more phosphate will be attached. It will form 3-phosphate. Okay. Now the first phosphate, which has been attached to acyclovir and ganciclovir, is attached by a molecule known as viral thymidine kinase. The enzyme of virus known as viral thymidine kinase attaches the first phosphate to acyclovir and ganciclovir. And after that, the next two phosphate are attached by human thymidine kinase, the human cell. Okay, human thymidine kinase. Now can we say it has now been formed, converted into a fake nucleotide? It has now been converted into fake nucleotide. Now this fake nucleotide, it will go to the DNA. Suppose this is a viral DNA, and this fake nucleotide, it will attach to the viral DNA, and DNA synthesis will take place. Okay. Now this DNA synthesis, remember, is taken care by DNA synthesis occur by an enzyme of a virus known as DNA polymerase. DNA polymerase will do viral DNA synthesis. The function of DNA polymerase is to attach these normal nucleotide. But this DNA polymerase will not able to understand or differentiate between a normal nucleotide or a fake nucleotide. So can we say they will competitively inhibit, they will competitively inhibit DNA polymerase, and hence they inhibit DNA synthesis, because this DNA polymerase will not able to distinguish between normal nucleotide and fake nucleotide of acyclovir and ganciclovir. Okay, so this is their mechanism of action. So they are competitive inhibitors of DNA polymerase. Now the point is, the acyclovir and ganciclovir, they have exactly same mechanism of action. Now what is the cause of resistance? Why resistance develops against acyclovir and ganciclovir? Resistance occurs due to mutation or alteration in viral thymidine kinase. Okay, this virus, it changes the types of thymidine kinase. This thymidine kinase changes, and these acyclovir and ganciclovir will not be converted into monophosphate. Hence, this step will be inhibited. Hence, if there is any mutation in viral thymidine kinase, this acyclovir and ganciclovir will not be converted into their monophosphate form. And second point, you're right, this is the most common cause of mutation. Rarely, DNA resistance may also occur due to DNA polymerase mutation. Mutation in DNA polymerase. Okay, it may also occur due to mutation in DNA polymerase enzyme. Okay, now the point is, you will write that in resistant cases of acyclovir, foscarnet and cidofovir is effective. Okay, foscarnet and cidofovir are effective drug in cases of resistance of acyclovir and ganciclovir. Now let's see what is the mechanism of action of foscarnet and cidofovir. Now cidofovir, you will write, it is a fake cytidine analog. It is a fake cytidine analog, and this cytidine, it goes inside the cell and gets converted into cytidine 3 phosphate only by human thymidine kinase. What does it mean? That this cidofovir does not require, it does not require viral thymidine kinase. It does not require viral thymidine kinase for its activation. So it gets activated only by human thymidine kinase, and it also inhibits DNA polymerase competitively. It also inhibits DNA polymerase competitively. So can we say, if the resistance is due to mutation or alteration of viral thymidine kinase, cidofovir is effective? Okay, cidofovir is effective if the resistance to acyclovir and ganciclovir is due to mutation or alteration in viral thymidine kinase, because cidofovir does not require activation by viral thymidine kinase. It only requires activation by human thymidine kinase. Okay, while acyclovir and ganciclovir, they require first viral thymidine kinase enzyme. But if the resistance is due to DNA mutation, remember, cidofovir is not effective. Cidofovir is not effective in DNA polymerase mutation, because like acyclovir and ganciclovir, it is also inhibiting DNA polymerase enzyme. But you will write foscarnet. Foscarnet directly inhibits attachment of nucleotide triphosphate to DNA. It directly inhibits the attachment of nucleotide triphosphate to DNA. Hence, it is effective in resistance cases of both. It is effective in resistant cases of both, either due to mutation of viral thymidine kinase and DNA polymerase mutation. Hence, foscarnet is a better drug in cases of resistant cases. Okay, so keep this thing in mind. Let's see the drugs, various drugs we have now. So let's start with the first drug, that is acyclovir and congeners. Okay, so the first point is acyclovir. By which route we give acyclovir? Acyclovir is given by almost all routes. It can be given orally, can be given IV, and it can be given as a topical drug. Okay, topical drug in cases of like herpetic keratitis, herpetis labialis, okay, or herpetis genital ulcer. Okay, genital lesions. Now, what is the activity of acyclovir? Remember, acyclovir is maximum effective against HSV1 and HSV2. That is herpes simplex virus 1 and herpes simplex virus 2. And in this cases, it is the drug of choice for herpes simplex virus 1 and 2. It is less effective against varicella zoster virus. It is less effective against varicella zoster virus, and it is not effective against cytomegalovirus. Okay, and human herpes virus 6. Acyclovir is not effective against cytomegalovirus and human herpes virus 6. So keeping this thing in mind, acyclovir is the drug of choice for both treatment and prevention of HSV virus infection. Okay, herpes simplex virus 1 infection. Remember, both in immunocompetent and immunocompromised people. Okay, both in immunocompetent and immunocompromised people, because herpes group of virus causes infection in both HIV patients also. Now, what is the dose? You will write the dose of acyclovir is, you will write, it is 200 milligram 5 times a day for at least 7 to 10 days. Or you can give 400 milligram 3 times a day for 7 to 10 days. Okay, 7 to 10 days. Now, you'll write where it is used. It is given for all herpes group of virus like herpes genitalis, which is caused by herpes simplex virus, herpes gingivostomatitis. Okay, you'll write mucocutaneous herpes. You'll write herpes encephalitis. And remember, in all cases, it is the drug of choice, that is acyclovir. Okay. In last two cases, we give acyclovir as an injectable drug because it's a very dangerous condition. Okay. In this cases, we give them as injectable drugs. Okay. Now, acyclovir is also approved for EBV infection, that is Epstein-Barr virus infection. And only in one Epstein-Barr virus infection known as oral hairy leukoplakia. Okay, oral hairy leukoplakia. Drug of choice is acyclovir. Now remember one point, that EBV infection, apart from this infection of Epstein-Barr virus, no other disease caused by Epstein-Barr virus has an antiviral drug. So it is the only Epstein-Barr virus infection, this site, which has an antiviral drug, acyclovir. No other treatment of any type of Epstein-Barr virus infection has a particular treatment. Okay, now let's see what is the side effect of acyclovir. The side effect of acyclovir is it is highly neurotoxic. Okay. And it is highly nephrotoxic. That means it causes decreased dose in renal failure. And in urine, it causes crystallinuria. It causes crystallinuria. But remember one point, that acyclovir is not myelosuppressive. There is no myelosuppression, which is also known as bone marrow suppression. No bone marrow suppression is seen with acyclovir. Okay, now remember, there are two antiviral drugs which does not show bone marrow. No bone marrow suppression is by acyclovir and foscarnet. These two drugs, they have same side effect, neurotoxic and nephrotoxic. But remember, bone marrow suppression is the main side effect of a drug. You'll write, it is the main side effect of a drug. You'll write ganciclovir and sidofovir. So it is a main side effect of ganciclovir, bone marrow suppression or myelosuppression. It is not seen with acyclovir and foscarnet. So it's a very important point which you must remember. Okay. Now let's talk about congeners of acyclovir. Okay. Acyclovir congeners. So the first drug you will write is valacyclovir. Now valacyclovir, remember, is a prodrug. Its active form is acyclovir. Its active form is acyclovir. So why we have converted acyclovir into valacyclovir? Because it has better oral bioavailability or absorption. Okay, better oral bioavailability or absorption. Second point you will write, it is more effective as compared to acyclovir against varicella zoster virus or chickenpox virus. Valacyclovir is more effective as compared to acyclovir. Okay. Now, second drug you will write is famciclovir. Which is a prodrug. Its active form is pencyclovir. Its active form is pencyclovir. So they are just like acyclovir. Remember, this famciclovir is given orally. This pencyclovir is given IV or topically. Only. Okay, It is given for IV and topically. Now, what is the use? It is same like acyclovir. Acyclovir like spectrum. Okay. Plus, remember, it has also HBV property. It is also effective against hepatitis B virus. But remember, it is not approved for hepatitis B virus group. So the activity of famicyclovir and pencyclovir is same like acyclovir, but they are also effective in hepatitis B virus, but they are not approved. Now just write certain topical drugs for herpes group of virus. Okay, topical drug, you can write a mnemonic: vitamin, VIT, vitamin CD. Okay, vitamin CD. So the first drug you will write is vidarabine. Okay, now vidarabine, remember, it's a fake nucleoside analog like acyclovir. Okay, it has been approved as a topical drug for herpes keratitis. Okay, vidarabine, remember, it is now not used, it is not given IV, it is not given IV. So they are topical drug, not IV, because now IV, it has been taken care or it has been surpassed by acyclovir. Okay, second drug you will write is idoxuridine. Idoxuridine, remember, it's a fake thymidine analog. Okay, fake thymidine analog. Again, it has been approved for herpes keratitis. Okay, and it is also, keratitis means corneal ulcers by herpes. Remember, it has been approved for herpes labialis, herpes genitalis, herpes zoster. These are the skin infection. Keratitis is the corneal. Now remember, idoxuridine is only given topically. Okay, and remember, it is never given IV or systemically because it is highly cardiotoxic. It is highly cardiotoxic, that is why it is never given IV or orally. And remember, it is given for DNA virus like herpes. Okay, it is not given for RNA virus. So there was one question when they asked, idoxuridine is given in RNA virus or DNA virus. Remember, DNA virus or herpes group of virus. Now T stands for, you will write, trifluoridine. Trifluoridine, you will write, it's a fluorinated pyrimidine analog. So as you are seeing, all these drugs, they are fake purines and pyrimidines. So these antiviral drug which we have discussed are fake purine and pyrimidine. Against, it has been approved for herpes keratitis or corneal ulcer. Okay, herpes keratitis or herpes corneal ulcer. Then you will write cidofovir. It is fake cytidine analog. Again given for herpes keratitis. Okay, and lastly you will write docosanol. Docosanol is a 10% saturated alcohol okay, and it has been approved for herpes labialis. Okay, herpes labialis or herpes orolabialis, if there is oral lesions also or lip lesions also, docosinol has been approved. So these are the topical drugs for herpes infection. Okay, now let's talk about the CMV, anti-CMV drugs now. Now the drug of choice for CMV virus, okay, that is ganciclovir. Okay, so ganciclovir, remember, is the drug of choice for CMV retinitis. CMV virus causes retinitis. It has been approved for CMV virus pneumonia, CMV virus colitis, and etc. if there is some other condition. But the most dangerous and the most important infection caused by cytomegalovirus is cytomegalovirus retinitis. Okay, now what is the route of administration of ganciclovir? Ganciclovir, remember, it cannot be given orally, not oral, not topical. Acyclovir can be given orally and topically. Ganciclovir is only given by injection. Okay, how it is given? Either it is given by intravenous injection or it is given by intravitreal injection. Why intravitreal injection into vitreous humor? Because of CMV retinitis. Okay, and nowadays we have made an eye implant of ganciclovir as well. Okay, in cases of CMV virus retinitis. Now why it is not given orally? Because it has a very low bioavailability. It is not absorbed orally. Low oral bioavailability, that is why. Because of this reason, we have made a new drug. That new drug is, that is valganciclovir. Now valganciclovir is an oral prodrug. Its active form is ganciclovir. Its active form is ganciclovir. Okay, so valganciclovir can be given orally because it has a good oral or better oral bioavailability. Better oral BA. BA stands for bioavailability. Now let's see what are the side effects of ganciclovir. The main side effect of ganciclovir is myelosuppression, which is not seen with acyclovir. Myelosuppression means bone marrow suppression. The bone marrow suppression is so severe that certain cases of fatal or life-threatening neutropenia has been observed with ganciclovir. Because of this reason, ganciclovir is absolutely contraindicated with one drug which itself causes bone marrow suppression or fatal neutropenia, that is an anti-HIV drug, zidovudine. Ganciclovir should never be combined with zidovudine because zidovudine itself causes bone marrow suppression, and zidovudine, remember, is a drug for HIV virus. Now the problem is this CMV retinitis, which we have discussed, is a very common infection in HIV virus. So if for HIV if you are giving zidovudine and for CMV virus ganciclovir you are giving, these drugs should not be combined together. So generally we don't give zidovudine, we replace zidovudine with some other drug. Okay, so remember this part. Okay, and second point, it is also neurotoxic, just like acyclovir. Okay, acyclovir. Now the next class of drug we have is foscarnet. Okay, now foscarnet. Now foscarnet, remember, it's an inorganic. Phos word is coming, so you write pyro phosphonate. Okay, phosphonate means phoscarnate. Now what does it mean? Suppose, let's see what is the mechanism of action. Okay, suppose this is a DNA and this DNA suppose has n nucleotides. Now how this DNA elongates, this DNA one nucleotide will come which contains 3-phosphate. It comes and attached to this DNA, and what happens, this DNA, it gets attached with nucleotide 1-phosphate. It gets attached to nucleotide 1-phosphate, and the remaining part of 2-phosphate, it becomes separated. Okay, so among this nucleotide 3-phosphate, only nucleotide monophosphate attaches to DNA. Okay, attaches to DNA. Now phoscarnate, what happens? Phoscarnate inhibit this attachment of nucleotide to this DNA. Okay, phoscarnate inhibit the attachment of this nucleotide to DNA. Now what will happen? How it will inhibit this phoscarnate? Cleavage of nucleotide 3-phosphate to nucleotide 2-phosphate, sorry, nucleotide monophosphate. Because this nucleotide monophosphate can get attached to DNA. Okay, so this cleavage of 2-phosphate from a nucleotide 3-phosphate is inhibited by phoscarnate. Okay, now where it is used, phoscarnate, remember, it is the drug of choice for acyclovir and ganciclovir resistant cases. Okay, it is the drug of choice for acyclovir and ganciclovir resistant cases. So acyclovir resistant cases of HSV1, HSV2 and varicella zoster virus, and ganciclovir resistant cases of CMV retinitis, we give phoscarnate. Okay, now what is the side effect of a phoscarnate? The side effect of phoscarnate is just like acyclovir. Remember, it is neurotoxic and it is nephrotoxic. Okay, while it does not causes bone marrow suppression, no bone marrow suppression or myelosuppression. Okay, no myelosuppression or bone marrow suppression by phoscarnate. Now point you have to remember, in nephrotoxicity phoscarnate causes loss of all ions in urine. It causes loss of all ions in the urine. Hence, what happens in blood? There is hypocalcemia. There is hypomagnesemia. Magnesium level in the blood reduces because it gets lost out in urine. And hypokalemia. Potassium level also reduces in blood. Okay. So, this is the side effect of phoscarnate. Now, next come to the next drug, that is Cidofovir. Okay, Cidofovir. Now Cidofovir, we know, is a fake cytidine analog. Okay, and it gets activated only by host thymidine kinase or human thymidine kinase. Okay, human thymidine kinase. So it does not require viral thymidine kinase. Okay, now how it is given? This Cidofovir is given orally. Okay, and it has been approved for, you will write, uses of Cidofovir. Cidofovir is given for all or majority of DNA virus. Majority of DNA viruses. We give Cidofovir. So let's see the uses. For uses, you will write a mnemonic. A. Gramp. Okay. It is given for acyclovir resistant cases of HSV-1 and HSV-2 and varicella zoster virus. It is given for ganciclovir resistant cases of CMV virus. But remember, the drug of choice in this case is foscarnet. Foscarnet is the drug of choice. Now R4, it is the drug of choice in these cases. The drug of choice in this case is Cidofovir. Now R stand for, it is the drug of choice for respiratory papillomatosis. Okay, it is a drug of choice for respiratory papillomatosis, which is caused by papillomavirus. It is given for adenovirus. It is a drug of choice for molluscum contagiosum, which is caused by pox virus. And it is also given for BK virus. BK virus causes nephrotoxicity or renal failure in renal transplant patient. And remember, all these viruses which we have written are DNA viruses. Okay, so it's a broad spectrum drug for DNA virus. Okay, now it is under trials for other DNA virus. It is under trial for smallpox virus. Cidofovir is under trial for smallpox virus and polyoma virus. Okay, so Cidofovir is under trial for smallpox virus and polyoma virus. Now the point is, in smallpox virus, recently one drug has been approved. That drug is a modification of Cidofovir. That drug is Brincidofovir. Same drug, but the name is little bit different. Brincidofovir has been approved for the treatment of smallpox virus. But remember, smallpox virus has been eliminated. Its infection is not seen nowadays. It has been eradicated. Brincidofovir is a reserve drug in cases of bioterrorism. If there is any case of bioterrorism with smallpox virus, then Brincidofovir is a reserve drug we made for smallpox virus. Okay. Now, what is the side effect of Cidofovir? Side effect is same like ganciclovir. Okay. Same like ganciclovir. So, this is all about the drugs we have for, sorry, the drugs for CMV. Now the new drugs for CMV retinitis. Now the new drug for CMV retinitis. The first drug you will write is fomivirsane. Now remember, any drug which ends with the word ursane, it will be an antisense oligonucleotide. Antisense oligonucleotide. That means, suppose this is an RNA of CMV virus. Antisense means it's a complementary strand. Antisense means complementary. Oligonucleotide means nucleotide sequence. This will go and attach to the CMV virus RNA and it will inhibit translation of proteins. Fomivirsane. Now, how fomivirsane is given? Fomivirsane, you will write, it is given as an intravitreal injection. Intravitreal injection in cases of CMV retinitis. Okay, and fomivirsen is the drug of choice in resistant cases. You can write resistant cases of ganciclovir, foscarnet, and cidofovir. Remember, for CMV virus, the drug of choice is ganciclovir. In ganciclovir resistant cases, we give foscarnet. Fomivirsen is even effective in foscarnet resistant cases. Okay? It is even effective in foscarnet resistant cases. Now, a new drug for this case is, we have is letermovir, a new drug which is also effective in resistant cases of CMV virus resistant to ganciclovir, foscarnet and cidofovir, that is letermovir. Letermovir, you will write, again there is no resistance against letermovir, it has been recently approved. Letermovir, it inhibit viral DNA terminal complex. Okay, viral DNA terminal complex. Now, what is the function of viral DNA terminal complex? Viral DNA terminal complex normally cut DNA into small particle, small fragment. And when DNA is cut into small particles, these DNA, they are assembled and packaging of DNA takes place. Assembly or packaging of DNA takes place and a viral protein will be formed, a whole virus will be formed. Now, just like fomivirsen, there is no cross resistance. Okay? So, fomivirsen and letermovir are the two new drugs which are effective in cases of ganciclovir, which is the drug of choice. In ganciclovir resistant cases, we give foscarnet. In foscarnet resistant cases, right now the drug of choice is fomivirsen, but a new drug which has been approved is letermovir in cases of CMV retinitis. Okay, so these are the all anti-herpes virus drugs we have. Okay, so now let's talk about the next virus, that is papilloma virus. Okay, now papilloma virus is a HPV, human papilloma virus. It generally causes an infection known as condyloma acuminata, which is also known as genital warts. Okay, and it may also cause cancers, especially cervical cancers. Okay, the most common strain which causes condyloma acuminata is HPV 6-11. Cancers is generally caused by highly virulent strain like HPV. You can write 16, 18, etc. Okay, so various strains. Now let's see first what are the treatment options do we have for condyloma acuminata treatment. Now treatment for condyloma acuminata, you will write, either this treatment is self-administered, the patient can administer itself, or it is administered by a doctor or clinician. A clinician will administer it. So patient cannot self-administer. So the drugs here which a patient itself can administer, they are given by topical creams. So patient itself can apply topical creams. The drugs are, you will write, PIS, PIS. P stand for podophyllotoxin. So it's a plant product as a topical cream. Imiquimod. Imiquimod creams are available. Imiquimod, we will discuss, it stimulates toll-like receptor. and it increases immunity of the body, and that immunity kills HPV virus. And you will write certain plant product known as sine catechins. Okay, it's directly kill HPV virus. Okay, now the treatment which is given by a doctor, patient itself cannot do. You will write a mnemonic, clicks. Okay, that is cryotherapy. Now cryotherapy is the safest, and it is the treatment of choice in pregnancy, etc. Okay, then you can give lasers. Then you will write interferons, interferon alpha. Okay, then you will write keratolytics. Now which keratolytics we use? Either we use trichloroacetic acid, you can also use salicylic acid, or you can do surgery like cautery, etc. So these are the treatment for human papilloma virus. Okay, now the point is, there is a drug, one anti-cancer drug which is not approved. There is one anti-cancer drug known as 5-fluorouracil. Now this drug is used topically, but remember, it is not approved. This drug has been used by many dermatologists as a topical cream for condyloma acuminata, but it is not an approved drug. Okay, so try to remember this. Now the last virus which we will discuss is RSV virus, that is respiratory syncytial virus. Okay, respiratory syncytial virus. Now respiratory syncytial virus, it causes clinical features of bronchiolitis, okay, which is sometimes known as bronchiolitis obliterans. It also causes pneumonias, etc. Okay, so the main infection caused by, now what is the treatment of RSV virus? Remember, RSV virus causes treatment generally in infants less than 2 years of age, and the most of the infections are self-limiting. Most of the infections are self-limiting. They don't require any particular antiviral drug. So what is the treatment? Remember, generally treatment is no antiviral drug, just supportive treatment. Okay, but there are exceptions. The patient will require antiviral drug in cases only if respiratory syncytial virus infection occurs in, you will write premature neonate with some heart abnormality. You'll write congenital heart disease. You'll write some lung abnormality. If that child is born with some lung abnormality like cystic fibrosis, you'll write bronchopulmonary dysplasia. Or lastly, if the child is immunocompromised, in these cases you will give antiviral drug, only in these cases. Otherwise, respiratory syncytial virus does not require any antiviral drug treatment. Now what is the management? You will write, for treatment, the drug of choice for RSV virus in these cases is aerosols of ribavirin. Aerosols of ribavirin. And for prevention, you will write injection of a monoclonal antibody known as palivizumab. Okay, palivizumab. So for treatment of RSV virus, remember the drug of choice is ribavirin. And for prevention, the drug of choice is palivizumab. Now, what is ribavirin? Ribavirin, we have already discussed in hepatitis C virus. It's an RNA polymerase inhibitor. So, for complete details, please refer to hepatitis C virus, where we have discussed ribavirin. And palivizumab is a monoclonal antibody against F protein of RSV virus. Okay, against F protein of RSV virus. So for treatment for RSV virus, respiratory syncytial virus, remember drug of choice is ribavirin. For prevention, the drug of choice for P is palivizumab. So this is all about the all antiviral drugs for all non-HIV viruses. So thank you very much for listening. Hello all, now let's start with influenza virus, the treatment of influenza virus. For influenza virus, the antiviral drugs against influenza, they are divided into two. Okay, they are divided into two. The first influenza antiviral drug you will write is M2, proton or protein, both are same, inhibitors. Okay, M2 protein inhibitors, and second we have is neuraminidase inhibitors. Okay, neuraminidase inhibitor. Okay, now let's see how influenza virus affects a human cell. So suppose, sir, this is an influenza virus which contains a RNA, single-stranded RNA, as a genetic material. On the surface of influenza virus, there are various proteins. Okay, there are various proteins on the envelope of influenza virus. Okay, now we will discuss about those proteins. Now remember, when influenza virus affects a human cell, it affects a human cell. How? It enters into the cell of the human, and this envelope, which contains a single-stranded RNA, this envelope shed off. Only single-stranded RNA comes outside. Okay? How this envelope is shed off? Remember, this envelope is shed off by, with the help of a protein which is present on the surface of envelope, that is known as M2 protein. Now, what this M2 protein will do? This M2 protein is a proton pump. It is a proton pump. This M2 protein will function, and the proton means H plus particle, it will move inside the virus. When it will move inside the virus, remember the pH of virus will become acidic, and in acidic pH, the envelope will shed off. Envelope will be removed, or envelope will be shed off. Okay. So this is the function of M2 protein. M2 protein is a type of proton pump. It influx H plus ions into the virus. When H plus ions will move inside the virus, H plus ions are also known as proton, the pH will become acidic, and the envelope of the virus is removed, and now single-stranded RNA virus will be formed. Now this RNA virus will form multiple copies. It will form multiple copies by replicating inside the virus, and again it will be converted into virus. It will be converted into multiple copies of virus. Now remember, to remove outside this virus, while its multiple copies are formed, this virus, it contains a protein on the surface which is known as sialic acid. Okay, it contains a protein on the surface of on their envelope, that is sialic acid. Now remember, this sialic acid must be removed. If this sialic acid is removed, only then the virus will exit out of the cell. Okay, only then it will release out of cell. So to exit of the virus, so that this virus can come out of the cell, sialic acid on the surface of the virus should be removed, and this sialic acid is removed by an enzyme, neuraminidase enzyme. This neuraminidase enzyme removes sialic acid present on the surface of virus so that this virus is exited out of the cell. Okay, so keeping this thing in mind, the first drug one we have is M2 protein inhibitors. Can we say M2 protein inhibitors, what is their mechanism of action? M2 protein inhibitors, they inhibit uncoating or shedding off virus envelope. Okay, virus envelope. Now among M2 protein inhibitors, we have two drugs. The first drug we have is amantadine, and the second drug, which is a longer acting form, is remantadine. Okay, amantadine and remantadine. Remantadine is longer acting. Okay, now the point is, these drugs, remember, M2 protein inhibitors, they are only effective for influenza type A. They are not effective against influenza type B. Okay, they are not effective against influenza type B, and nowadays they are not considered as a drug of choice for influenza. Okay, now they are not considered as a drug of choice for influenza. The drug of choice for influenza now has become neuraminidase inhibitor. They have become now drug of choice. Okay, so M2 protein inhibitors are not the drug of choice, neuraminidase, because neuraminidase inhibitor, I will be telling you, they will be effective against influenza type B as well. Okay, now remember, these drugs, amantadine, they are also used in Parkinson's disease. They are also having anti-Parkinsonism effect. They also have anti-Parkinson's disease effect. Okay. For the use of amantadine in Parkinson's disease, please refer to the CNS topic of Parkinson's disease. They are given in levodopa-induced dyskinesia. Okay. Now, remember, what is the side effect? How they are given? First point, what is the route in influenza? These drugs are given orally. Okay. And what is the side effect? You will write, these drugs, their main side effect is just like levodopa, which we use in Parkinson's disease. They cause nausea and vomiting. Okay. They cause peptic ulcer. Okay. Third, you can write, they precipitate narrow angle glaucoma. We have discussed the side effect in cases of Parkinson's disease. Please refer why they occur. Okay. In CNS, they cause seizures or convulsions. okay? And lastly, you will write they may cause nephrotoxicity. They may cause nephrotoxicity. Now remember one point. If a patient of narrow angle glaucoma comes to you, history of seizure comes to you, or with severe renal failure comes to you, severe renal failure will come to you, amantadine is absolutely contraindicated. Amantadine is absolutely contraindicated. Now, very peculiar side effect of amantadine, you will write, is livido reticularis. Okay, it causes livido reticularis. Suddenly the skin color will change. Okay, so for these side effects of amantadine, please refer to Parkinson's disease. Now let's talk about neuraminidase inhibitor. Okay, now neuraminidase inhibitor, remember, they have become now the drug of choice for influenza because they are effective against influenza type A as well as type B. They are effective against both influenza type A, influenza type B. Let's write certain types of influenza type A. They are the drug of choice for H1N1 influenza, which is also known as swine flu. You'll write they are also the drug of choice for H5N1, which is also known as avian or bird flu. So they have become the drug of choice for influenza type A and type B. And remember, for both treatment and for both prophylaxis. Okay, for both treatment and prophylaxis, they have become the drug of choice. Now let's see what are the drugs and what are their mechanism of action. So their mechanism of action is they inhibit neuraminidase. Because of this reason, sialic acid is not removed. Sialic acid is not removed. Because of this reason, they will inhibit the release or exit of viral progeny. The virus will not able to come outside the cell. Okay, viral progeny, remember. So what are the drugs? These drugs, they will end with the word mivir. So these drugs, they will end with the word mivir. So let's see what are the drugs we have. The first drug we have is oseltamivir. Okay, which comes with the brand name Tamiflu. Comes with the brand name Tamiflu. You'll write zanamivir and piramivir. Okay, piramivir. These are the three approved drugs which are neuraminidase inhibitor. What is their route of administration? You'll write these three are given IV. But apart from this, oseltamivir can be given orally as well. Okay, it can be given orally as well. Zanamivir is given nasally as well. Okay, and no other route of administration of piramivir. Piramivir is only given parenterally or IV. Now, why zanamivir is given nasally, not orally? It is not given orally because it has very low oral bioavailability. That is why it is given by inhalational route. Okay, inhalationally. Okay, so zanamivir inhalationally, oseltamivir orally. Okay, so these are the route. Why zanamivir is not given orally? Because it has a oral, less oral bioavailability. Now let's see what are the side effect of these drug. The main side effect of oseltamivir, you will write, is nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea. The main side effect of piramivir is also diarrhea. The main side effect of zanamivir is asthma. because when it is given inhalationally, it may provoke asthma or bronchospasm. Okay, bronchospasm. Now the last point you will write that these two drugs, zanamivir and piramivir, they are even effective in oseltamivir resistant cases. They are even effective in oseltamivir resistant cases. And you will write the drug of choice for influenza for both treatment and prophylaxis is right now oseltamivir. Okay, oseltamivir is the drug of choice for both treatment and prophylaxis of influenza, both type A and B, both type A and B, and both for swine flu, avian flu, etc. And in resistant cases, you can give zanamivir and piramivir. Okay. Now there is a new drug known as leninamivir. Now this leninamivir, remember, it is only approved in Japan. It is not approved in India and America. And how it is given? It is also given IV as well as nasally. The good thing about leninamivir is a longest acting drug. It is longest acting. Okay. It is approved only in Japan. Now let's see, keeping this thing in mind, what is the treatment of influenza? Influenza virus. So we will write treatment and prophylaxis. Okay, you'll write treatment and prophylaxis. So the first drug we have is oseltamivir. And it is considered as a drug of choice. Okay, for treatment and prevention, the dose is, you will write 75 milligram twice a day, that means BD, for 5 days. And for prophylaxis, you will write 75 milligram OD. OD means once a day for 7 days. Okay, for 7 days. Now just remember one point. This is the dose in adults. Okay, in adults. For treatment in children, for the treatment in children, remember, the dose must be calculated according to body weight of adult. According to body weight. So we will compare the body weight of a child with adult and we will give the treatment. In children, it can be given, oseltamivir can be given at all age group. Okay. But for prophylaxis, it should be given for more than 3 months only. It should not be given in children less than 3 months. Okay. Oseltamivir should not be given for less than 3 months. Now, the second point you will write, that these drugs, when they are given for treatment, the treatment must be started. Treatment must be started within 2 days. Treatment must be started within 2 days, okay, of influenza virus. And what about prophylaxis? You'll write prophylaxis should be given at least for 4 weeks. Okay, at least for 4 weeks. Okay, after first week of, sorry, after the first case of influenza virus is reported in community. Okay, that means after the first case has been given, The treatment in the community should be given for next 4 weeks, within next 4 weeks, to all individual. And the treatment should be given for 7 days. Okay, for prophylaxis, the treatment should be given for 7 days, and it should be given within 4 weeks to the whole community. Okay, within 4 weeks to the whole community. The next point you will write, the drug which is given, so this oseltamivir, remember, it is given for both A and B. Now we also give zanamivir. Okay, zanamivir, for the treatment zanamivir, it is also given for A and B. For treatment zanamivir, the doses for treatment and for prophylaxis, you'll write zanamivir, it is given for treatment 10 milligram BD twice a day for 7 days, sorry, for 5 days. And for prophylaxis, 10 milligram OD for 7 days. And it is given by inhalational route. Okay, inhalational route. Third point, you will write with piramivir. Now, just before coming to piramivir, remember the treatment should be given for children more than 7 years of age. And prophylaxis is given for children more than 5 years of age. Below them, they are contraindicated. Okay. Piramivir, you will write, it has been approved only for treatment. It has not been approved for prophylaxis. Okay. And it is given for treatment for more than 18 years of the age. Only in the children who are more than 18 years. What is the dose of piramivir? Piramivir is given as a single IV injection, only for treatment, at a dose of 600 milligram in children more than 18 years of age for both influenza A and B. It is not given for prophylaxis. Okay, and only for children more than, or people for more than 18 years. Zanamivir, treatment for more than 7 years. Prophylaxis for children more than 5 years. And what about oseltamivir? Treatment for all age group, and prophylaxis for children more than 3 months of the age. Okay, so this is the treatment of influenza virus.